So hi, my name is Craig Smith. I'm a longtime New York Times correspondent and host of an AI podcast. AI, as we all know, is probably the most powerful emerging technology in the world, and it has tremendous potential to improve education at scale. But that doesn't happen naturally. It requires the buy-in from different stakeholders. And among those stakeholders, the most important are the teachers. So in this session, we've invited teachers from around the world to engage in a discussion about AI in education. The teachers are the frontline workers of education. We have people from different domains and different backgrounds. I think we're really fortunate to have a group from such diverse backgrounds and from such diverse geographies. So let's see how the six of you spend your time and how that relates to how you see your role as a teacher. Jennifer, could you start?
Absolutely. Well, my breakdown looks way different than everybody else's, but I think it speaks to my discipline, student instruction and tutoring and so forth takes a vast amount of my time because I do math. And so I spend a lot of time figuring out how to help the students understand the concepts, be able to apply them, be able to engage them outside of the classroom. That's pretty much where the vast amount of my time is spent in the interaction directly one-on-one with the students. But then preparing, I know everybody says math is math and always has been math, but I believe that it's a growing field and it is definitely in flux in how you teach it and how you present it and what you do. So I'm always trying to prepare and newer, better ways of doing things. So,
Hi everyone, I'm Jen. So as you can probably see, I'm a bit of a workaholic, but as I spend about a third of my time in the classroom, so about 20, 21 hours or so. And during that time, obviously, I am trying to engage kids. Our school is heavily subscribed to project-based learning. So rather than lecturing every day and making students do worksheets or other activities, we usually engage in group projects that have some kind of real-world relevance or implication for the content that they're learning. So I do spend most of my time not only implementing those projects, but preparing for them. And you see also I spend 10 hours a week on administrative tasks. That's because of my role as the school's technology coordinator. So I work very closely with the site leadership, the principal, but also with the district leadership to try to implement plans throughout our district. The rest preparation I already talked about, that directly impacts the projects that we do, and also assessment. As a history teacher, I do read a lot of essays and papers. So most of our assessments even are open-ended and skills-based. So there's not a whole lot of room with our current platforms for the kind of automating that process. So I have to actually go and read them. So that's an opportunity I'm also thinking as AI can also help, because to help with kind of essay grading and grading skills, which is what we try to focus on.
Hi, everyone. So the school where I work at actually works with active methodology, and due to the pandemic and all the adaptations we have to face now, I saw a big change in the time that we actually spend with student instruction and engagement due to motivation, not only content and participation, but for students to be the center of their learning, it takes time, just like Jennifer was mentioning earlier, because they are the ones responsible for most of the time. So I guess that's the reason why we spend so many hours dedicating to students' instruction and engagement. As for behavior, social and emotional skills development, our school works with a core program, which is about developing social emotional skills. So we take that in consideration. Therefore, it's a big part of our dedication as well. Preparation, administration is also a big part. As teachers, we know how much artificial intelligence can perhaps help us reducing those hours so we can actually be more productive and engaged.
I also spend most time in student instruction and engagement as an English subject teacher. I would like to provide students with as many authentic resources as possible so that they are exposed to real world English usage and motivated and entertained throughout the classes, regardless of their levels. This might be plenty of appropriate video clips, including key expressions or key terms to help them realize how to apply and expand what they learned in class. And I also believe that there are things that only school classroom settings can create compared to other learning environments where they learn English, such as encouraging collaboration and critical thinking through group work. That's why I try to constantly make my students think and help each other in class.
I'm lucky enough that I have computers for every kid in the classroom, so I can use them to give them online materials. It depends on the subject I'm teaching at the moment, but when I'm able to find online materials, I found that the way the best way for the students, because they can work at their own pace and they can follow along the materials. One of the problems is that when you address the whole classroom, you're losing the ones behind. So self-paced education, I think, is critical here, and that allows them to progress at their own pace.
I also spend a lot of time in instructions and in feedback, not only orally, but also using the laptops. And it's my privilege to make it this way and to collect the data for every student about its individual progress. For example, I also think that it is very important to improve the social skills, not only the academic skills during our lessons. So I have the same situation as Yang Wong about the communicative skills and soft skills. That's why I take a lot of time to take a lot of attention to student behavioral and social skills and their improvement. So if you want to learn something, you just try it. So consequently, if we're talking about social skills, the best way to teach them is to give them a try. It's role-playing games, first of all, definitely, and geography is a good field for role-playing games. And second part, I would say, is discussion, roundtable discussions and role-playing discussions.
If you could each reallocate your time, what things would you spend less time on and what things would you spend more time on? And how does that relate to the way you think of your fundamental role as a teacher?
Considering, I believe that the teacher's role is more being a facilitator or moderator in this learning process, I would definitely not change the amount of time that we spend with student instruction and engagement. So perhaps the administration and evaluation can be something we use artificial intelligence, and also thinking about the assignments and lessons we plan as to focus also on behavior and social emotional skills development. So perhaps I would cut some hours in the mechanical part of the correction, evaluation and administration.
Yeah, with great pleasure. I pretty much agree with Elisa. I also think that the main role of the teacher in 21st century, first of all, is moderator or facilitator. We tend to move from direct instructions to peer education and to plain education, and so as we discussed with Elisa before. So I agree that I would like to transfer my job time from direct instructions to focus on them, discussions and social skills improvement.
Well, I agree with my colleagues that teacher is definitely more of a moderator, facilitator. I don't believe that diminishes my responsibility to give my information and to provide my knowledge, but I do believe it requires me to help lead them towards that knowledge and not just do an information dump on my students. I love how much time I interact with my students. I wish I had more of it. I wish I had more time to one-on-one feedback. I would also like to have more class preparation. You know, it's the only job where you spend all your time preparing to go to your job and then actually doing your job and then coming home and, you know, wrapping up your job. So your job is 24/7. And as a parent, as a wife, you know, sometimes that's just not as possible as I would absolutely love it to be. I'd love to be able to walk in and be super teacher every single day. Because I think my students absolutely deserve that.
That's interesting. We'll talk when we start talking about the applications of AI to education about how that can provide personalized attention, both through the technology, but also by freeing up the teacher to have more time with individual students.
The most time I'm addressing the whole classroom at once, that I move to individually getting the most out of these students who are ahead of the average, and trying to get all these kids who are way behind on board. That's valuable. I think that's the most valuable usage of my time.
I mostly agree with all of my colleagues, and I want to spend less time in administration, especially in terms of dealing with paperwork and budgets, and spend more time in both student behavioral, social, emotional skill development, and student coaching and advisement. Both of my roles as an English teacher and a homeroom teacher, I want more time to, and I want to invest more time in one-to-one interaction and giving individual feedback. And for me, being a teacher means being a lifelong mentor and role model for students. I feel a great sense of responsibility for being a good mentor for my students. So I also usually focus on whole person development. These entail a lot of things. And first, it's about taking care of my students' social and emotional development, teaching them how to embrace who they are. And when it comes to career exploration, it's also important to keep track of their individual motivation and progress in order to help them prepare for future labor markets in the sort of ever-changing AI world. I try to give counseling to or have small talks with my students on a daily basis so that they know where they are going and how they should manage their time. So obviously I need more time for these two, considering what being a teacher means to me.
Yeah, that's very interesting. And hopefully technology can relieve some of the burdens that or take care of some of the tasks that keep you and the other teachers away from focusing on individual students. You guys have access or have used many of you technology in your classrooms. There, I know Jennifer, for example, uses an auto grading technology. One of you mentioned online courses that students can access outside the classroom or in the classroom. Many of you use learning management systems. a few of you mentioned gamification learning. It's amazing the variety of tools that are available. What do each of you think AI can uniquely add? What kind of AI solution would be game-changing for you? Javier, could we start with you? You were participated in a Kaggle challenge late last year. Can you talk about the capabilities of AI in assessing student knowledge?
Sure. Like you said, Craig, I participated in a competition organized by Riiid. I was researching AI in my free time. And since maybe 4 years ago, and I didn't know that there was an application in education for AI at that time. So I came across this competition and it progressively started appearing clear to me. And what they wanted was to predict to be able for the machine to predict what the answer of a student is going to be based on the previous answers to questions made to that student. And then I started thinking what might be the goals of having such information, being able to predict what a kid is going to answer to a question. And then I started seeing a few applications. One of them, which is to be able to give them a personalized experience. They have this application. Well, I have to say that the data they were collecting was from an application aimed at preparing a certificate, an English certification, the TOEIC certification. Mm-hmm. So what they do is they first grade you with 9 or 10 questions and they give you a level and then you start from that level. So at the very beginning, they're giving you questions according to your level. But the thing is that as you go along the process of learning, they modify the path based on the answers that you are giving to all the questions they give you. So they effectively are personalizing your path. And actually more than they're personalizing it, but the main goal is to have you get that certification. So that means having you not drop out of the process. Mm-hmm. And keeping you engaged. And so that's a very interesting application of AI. I think this is one of the safest applications. So every country had the problem of how do I grade these students who have missed 1/3 of the year. So one of the things they did in the UK is they used an AI, but they failed because they were giving better grades to kids from regions who normally get good grades. So you're actually penalizing kids from poorer areas who normally as an average don't get good grades, and you may have a very good kid from that area and have that artificial intelligence penalize. It's a very safe one. I think it's the natural one to being able to individually plan what the curricula is going to be. As long as you have enough data from the students, I think you can apply this to any discipline. The only thing is that English is a perfect match for this. This is a perfect use case scenario for AI where you have a lot of tabular data and it has a lot of variables. The amount of time it takes you to answer the question, when they ask you the question, maybe you're worse on Mondays and maybe you're better on Fridays. The amount of time it took you to answer the question and what kind of, it's a grammar question, those are variables, and it's very easy for the artificial intelligence to predict what you're going to. I think the data is the most important thing to collect.
I would say that there are a couple of things that in fact revolutionize the educational process when we're speaking about AE. First of all, it's learning management systems. Big deal for me because a learning management system allows us to collect data about the students, and it also allows students to get access to the educational materials and to the data wherever they want and wherever they need it. This issue can solve the problem when, you know, during the lesson, my student simply can't give an access to the information that he needs or she needs. And learning management systems allow us to solve this issue. It also allows us to solve the issue of not knowing the previous path of my student. I have a new student, I have no idea what he was learned, what he learned before, what he was taught before, what experience does he or she has. Using a learning management system, we can solve this issue also, because I can see the path and I can access the path dependency of the student. The second big point I would say is there are assessment systems and tests that can be taught, that can, smart tests, I mean. It is an IEAE issue because it is a testing system that adapts to the level of the student. When my student passed through the test will be more complicated or more easy depending on the previous census. And it is a big deal because it allows us to slash a huge amount of time, which normally a teacher should spend while making the testing systems. We can do it automatically, and it is the smart systems
that. Yeah, and something else you mentioned, which was interesting, is the technology can track a student's progress and knowledge. And then when you get a new student, you can immediately see that student's background. And a little bit what Javier was saying, that this knowledge tracing, I was a kid that moved around a lot growing up from school to school. And, you know, the teachers had no idea who I was, what my level was. And frankly, in most cases, just ignored me. But I can see the value as a student, new student comes in, you immediately have an understanding of what they're good at, what they're weak at, how motivated they are, and that sort of thing. That's fascinating. Let's go on. Jungwon, can you talk about what you would like AI in education to do, what you think would be game changing?
I mostly agree with what Javier said, especially he talked about the test prep application, and I also have the similar idea. I think AI can play a big role in personalization of education by tracking students in various ways during learning process. This can be realized with AI tutors. Being able to assess individual students' performances and behaviors in more depth, AI enables tailored teaching and detailed feedback. Let's imagine a situation. To achieve learning goals, students are given and solve a set of questions a teacher specifically set for them. Then data analyzed from students' performances are provided to the AI tutor so that it can constantly diagnose individual students' strong and weak points and adjust the types and the levels of questions accordingly. The set of questions are decided through the algorithm optimizing their learning. As the time goes by, the algorithms become more delicate and concrete, helping students meet learning goals. I hope this will ultimately help reduce learning gaps by addressing the needs of students at varying performance levels. Especially as you all know, during this pandemic, students' abilities and the learning gaps have been widened. So we like to help students who are left behind. So we are collaborating with the engineers of Riiid team.
I see. Can you talk just a little bit before we go on about motivation? Can you see AI improving student motivation or engagement? Again, I was a student who had a relatively low motivation in the classroom. I was very interested in things outside the classroom, academically, but in the classroom, I was usually bored to tears. And I can see that had I had a teacher or a technology that was more engaging, is there a way that you can see AI improving student engagement?
Yeah, we try to include a part that motivates students' engagement, especially by including the gamification function, because we are targeting the middle schoolers, and I know their concentration span is very short. So we try to seek ways to entertain them, like constantly entertain them with the maybe sounds and with some characters that are interesting. Yeah, those kind of engagement. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. Jennifer, what do you see as the best way to apply AI to education? And on the subject of gamification, I'm curious, and motivation, whether that's something you've thought about.
Yeah, we call it buy-in in the education field. We need to get the students to buy in to what we're doing. Gamification is, in my opinion, a fantastic way of doing that, because one of the things kids like is to see how far they've come and to have the challenge of how far they need to go. That's why my son stays up late trying to get to the next level and doesn't want to put the controller down until mom is like, no, put the controller down. Because that's what pulls them into the game, the idea they can get to the next level, they can do the next thing and conquer the next problem. So gamification is huge, but I wish there was something a little bit more individual path oriented. I'm hoping that's a direction that AI does go in differentiation, but authentic differentiation, not just a checking the boxes, really streamlining it to that student.
Elisa, can you talk about AI and how it could improve teaching for you?
What I miss the most, basically, is that artificial intelligence can enable a whole person assessment. Nowadays, students' evaluation is basically separated according to subjects. It would be great if IA technology could help unite everything so that we connect all students' skills, so we have this holistic view of each student. But I'd like to emphasize that I'm not talking about a holistic view that is just random or based on personal impressions. It's a holistic view that can be connected with the skills data as evidence to this holistic approach, providing us incredible opportunity to personalize learning, just like Jennifer was mentioning earlier. Differentiation, but it has to be specific and it has to be focused on each student's needs. So for me, that would be a big game-changing scenario if we could have a way of bringing it all together so that schools can see the student, the individual as a whole process and not only by subject, you know?
I think the biggest opportunity here is how AI can democratize personalized learning for everyone. So if you think back just how the internet, more specifically, I guess, Wikipedia, democratized information to everybody about 20 years ago. Now, the next level, I think, is to democratize that individual support to everybody. So about 3 years ago, our school district partnered with a company back then called Gracelems, now called Paper, is a Canadian company that provides 24/7 tutoring services to online tutoring services to students, and it's chat-based. So a student can log on at say 10 p.m. if they're stuck on a problem and their teacher is not available, and they would log on. It'll be a licensed or credentialed teacher on the other end to help with the problem. And And I kind of looked through the records of a lot of those interactions, and the teacher never just said, oh, the answer is five. The tutor, on the other hand, would start by saying, what do you know about the Pythagorean theorem? Okay, and lead the student through discovering the answers for themselves. And after seeing so much of it, I'm absolutely convinced that there's a script or algorithm that all those tutors had gone through as part of their training for grade slam or paper. So, essentially what AI does, right? It's adaptive, as you mentioned many times before, and it predicts. That's what AI is mainly, I think the main strength of AI compared to some of the more traditional tech platforms. And I witness also as students repeatedly go on to this tutoring service, and sometimes when they come across the same tutor, by chance, the tutor already knows something about the student, and they can immediately adapt their services to that student. And again, that's what AI can do. Now, this was a relatively expensive service, and obviously because the service had to hire tutors and pay them, whereas with AI, you probably don't have to pay a computer to offer those services. So I think if we can offer those type of services for much cheaper than what my district paid for, then there's a great opportunity to service people in, for example, poorer areas, right? Or students without access to great good teachers, for example. So I think that's the greatest opportunity here. As Javier mentioned before, AI failed in the UK because of socioeconomic differences between regions. And as we all witnessed that now Chromebooks are dropping to the point where you can get one for $150, $200. And so this is a great opportunity to level the playing field. I happen to work in a very wealthy, small district. And so I've seen but I used to work in a very large, poor district. So I've seen the stark differences between the different levels of education in any country, I'm assuming. So this is the biggest game changer, the biggest opportunity with AI. And of course, another aspect of that, the desire for it is the AI to somehow help teachers or help students directly learn some of those soft skills, learn like critical thinking, leadership. Definitely a reach goal or stretch goal for AI at this point for me. But in the immediate future, I definitely see this democratization of learning, quality personalized learning as the biggest opportunity for AI.
Help, you've all talked about personalization and evaluation. Assessments today are done primarily through one-off testing. Often called summative testing. It sort of sums up what a student has learned. And AI has the promise of a formative testing or formative assessment where the student is assessed continuously throughout their learning path. Can we talk about how that can be used to improve education?
I think we're kind of collectively in agreement that the traditional way of doing assessments needs to change because these high stakes tests are overwhelming to our students and they're not authentically assessing what they are doing. Traditionally, formative assessments are actually very time consuming because you would call on a student in the classroom. And you have to make sure you call on every student in the classroom or calling them up to the board or an exit ticket, a bell ringer. All of those take a lot of time. With high stakes testing, there is a greater risk of having false negatives just because there's far more variables involved. And there's also risk of having false positives because you have to gear your test for a certain time frame. And sometimes the questions are written to keep time in mind, and it's mm-hmm. not really a true assessment of the full knowledge. It's just a surface question instead of really hitting what you need to hit all the way. So sometimes teachers will go, oh, they got such and such a score, but the test is not necessarily a great test. It's just the kid knew how to take that test very well.
Yeah.
And so that's a false positive. So I'm hoping that AI levels the playing field on formative assessments, makes it more accessible for teachers to do more formative assessments. Formative assessments are really the crux of how a student learns. And I think they're so necessary, but because of the time constraints, we use them as little as possible, or we tend to sparsely use them. And when they're at your fingertips and you're using them constantly, you can go from one to the next very quickly. And so I think that the formative assessments, to me, is the biggest area of where I'm going to enjoy the AI. And I think it's going to personally impact my classroom.
Yeah. Are any of you using formative assessment tools right now? Because I know one of the things I was going to ask, there's some resistance among parents even to formative assessment, because they want the grades and they want the test scores because those are useful benchmarks in society in job placement and that sort of thing. So if you could talk about how you use formative assessment, Jongwan, and then anybody else who's using it actively.
I think I have to explain first about what's going on in Korean education at the moment. I think Korea is slowly passing the transition period when it comes to education and evaluation. By the transition period, I mean it's going towards diversifying evaluation methods. This is necessary, I think, to improve education as a whole. In Korea, due to the underlying system and the overall social atmosphere, as Mr. Smith mentioned, students have been under a lot of pressure to excel others and prove themselves to be academically competent all the time and to get into so-called like prestigious universities. And all kinds of standardized tests, including 수능, which is CSAT of Korea, hold high significance. So it also affects teachers' freedom to instruct their students based on their own materials and their own methods, as they may not be in line with what should be taught for standardized tests. Mm-hmm. However, there have been some changes, of course. There are the new 2015 revised national curriculum and a free learning semester or year, which is similar to a gap year for first graders in middle school, and a new credit system for high school students and the work study door system and so on. And these are all for reducing effects of high stake exams and to embrace a broader spectrum of all students. And also there have been some continuous trials and changes to adjust systems of evaluation and college admission in order to appreciate various characteristics and abilities of all different students.
I see. I mean, one of the promises of formative assessment is that not all students will be learning at the same speed or at the same level, and teachers can see in the background where students need help and throughout their learning path. I mean, I imagine it as a series of line graphs for students, and you can see who the top performer is, who's not performing, and then you can take time to focus on those that are not performing to bring them up. Do any of you have any thoughts about using that kind of a system to personalize education.
Craig, could I say something about what you were talking about with the parents not not really seeing formative assessment? I think that's part of my job as a teacher to tell them really what formative assessments are, because they're seeing that as the ungraded portion, and then the summative tests are seeing as the graded portion. And I try to help them understand the more formative testing that they have coming through this process, the better off the summative testing is going to be. Mm-hmm. So if you allow the process to work correctly, because it's a corrective process, that's really what it is. It helps me see where they are, their benchmark as far as understanding, and then putting them on the correct path to get to the end result with everybody else collectively. So the more I stress formative testing helps with the end result of the summative testing, the more my parents are understanding of why I have so many different assessments before the big test or before the, the chapter review or whatever. But I think what you're saying is the line graphs and the different information is helpful on an individual level, but then when they converge, then your understanding of yourself as a teacher also improves, because if they're converging, I have hit my target. I am doing something correct, and I can assess myself in that process as well. I'm imparting the information the way that needs to be on multiple different levels so that the entirety of the class is included and they're all understanding. So I think it's formative assessments are not just for the student, they're very much for the teacher as well.
I think that AE is a big help here, because I don't think, of course, we can personalize our students' education by just using another hours of our own job. We have a good experience in our school using our platform. We can allow our kids, our students, to pass through them in the using the speed and time that are comfortable for them. So if some of them do not not have enough time during the lesson, during my lesson, to pass all the exercises, they can have another time, additional time at home. If on the contrary, if they are faster than the whole class, and all of us have such a students, they can just go further, or they can pass through more complicated exercises than the main part of the class. And here is personalization. A person can choose the level of complexity. He or she can choose the number of exercises, and he or she can choose the speed.
Yeah, Elisa, can you talk a little bit about how AI can revitalize the true purpose of assessment, make it enjoyable for students, hopefully?
Yeah, I'd like to comment on that, because basically I can see that worldwide we're all transitioning from something a little bit more traditional to something that considers not only summative but also formative assessment. Mm-hmm. And that's linked to what parents want to understand from the educational process of their kids. Mm-hmm. But if we think about that yearly academic test is not actually what measures the learning process, and we try to focus a little bit more on the learning, student learning outcomes of every area of knowledge, we are helping them and facilitating their work in schools. We have to consider that the idea is not to penalize students. So in order for parents, because of obvious reasons, but also for students to understand the process, we have to find a way to make that learning achievement visible. So if we make learning visible, I actually believe that things will be easier for us to, as Jennifer was mentioning, be stronger on the formative assessment, so that the summative final result can be not only positive, but we can start really valuing the process and not only a number in the end. And I hope actually that artificial intelligence can help somehow revitalize the true purpose of assessment and make it enjoyable for students as much as the learning process is visible, you know?
Yeah. Part of the problem is getting these systems integrated into educations, into the classrooms. June, I know that you work a lot on that. Can you talk about how you're able to integrate, what sorts of tools you're able to integrate, and how you see that integration going forward? Is there a day when the classroom will look very different than it does today?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. That's progress. The traditional classrooms, rows and rows of desks have, you know, that was invented during the industrial age to train factory workers to be in lines for the rest of their lives. So obviously, as part of my job, we reimagine a lot of things, including the furniture arrangement and everything. And this kind of ties into everything we've been talking about, is just how we have to fight this inertia, whether it's our parents or you know, older teachers or whatever, and to fight this kind of inertia. We in my school, we went from the grassroots ground up sort of level. We took volunteers from teachers first, have them pilot, and then try to demonstrate the benefits of it, and then based on their needs, and then move up. Because we've seen large districts or institutions mandate all teachers to use certain platforms, and that hasn't gone well. Most teachers are dragged along, kicking and screaming. Most the technology, or a lot of the technology, ended up collecting dust in storage. I'm sure you've seen all of that. So as part of my job as tech coordinator, I actually read a book called Nudge, written by the Nobel laureate Richard Thaler, on behavioral psychology and behavioral economics, about how to not mandate, but nudge people into doing things. It might take time, especially when, but if something we're doing gains acceptance with a good chunk of the teachers, and we, I guess, sell it to the parents in the mm-hmm. right way, and frame the, well, obviously explain and frame the purpose of what we do to the students in the right way, then organically this will eventually grow.
As a teacher, as a parent, and as a colleague, and I was also involved in I was a technology coordinator for several years. I understand the frustration on all angles of this. And I would say the greatest thing for teachers pushing against new technology is the time investment. It mm-hmm. is a ginormous amount of time to invest on figuring out the system, figuring out how to utilize the system. You have to see the advantages to it. You have to really know ahead of time that if I make it through this excessive amount of time that I'm going to invest in it, I'm going to reap exponentially rewarded from it. But that's not always easy to sell. And so sometimes you have to model it yourself. Sometimes you have to model it amongst a few of the colleagues, and then their excitement as they're creating that in the classroom. But you have to have an administration who is willing to set you up for success. And one of that is going to be not enforcing a standard across the board for everybody. Because as soon as you say every single person has to do such and such, then everybody's going to do it at varying levels, and some are going to just barely do it to squeak by, and that lowers the success of it in your school, really, because it's diminishing the impact in the classroom, and kids get frustrated. And I think when they begin to see the results coming down the pike, they're more willing to jump on board. But I think it takes teachers who are willing to put in that time investment.
You've all been extremely patient. This has gone on a lot longer than we intended, partly because I'm so interested in it. Can we just run through each of you for some final thoughts on how you see AI changing education or things that struck you in the conversation today? Elisa, why don't we start with you, and then we'll run across through the group.
Well, AI is something that definitely contributes a lot in a very positive way for our work in the educational field. I would like to comment that perhaps we should go back to the beginning of this talk and remember the amount of hours we spend doing everything related to this process. And perhaps we have to consider that teachers have to work hard not only to learn how to make the best use of all the apps and artificial intelligence tool, but also to endorse new skills as teachers' roles are now completely different nowadays, mm-hmm. especially after this COVID experience that made everything faster, all developments and projects and new ways of guiding students in this monitoring process. Yeah. But definitely artificial intelligence is something that can bring us lots of benefits. And I'm looking forward to see what's new in the market to make our lives easier, but with like a high quality control.
Yeah. Jongwon Moon, any final thoughts?
Basically agree with Elisa. This pandemic accelerated a lot of changes, both for teachers and students, and AI will definitely do more for everybody. And I think we, especially in Korea, we need to form a shared understanding of its benefits still among teachers and students and parents and administrators. Also the forums and discussions among communities of teachers, engineers and policymakers should be held often so that experts in different fields collaborate for the best. In terms of resources and technology, I think we have best resources such as good internet connection and maybe a relatively small digital divide among people. So I think once we have this shared understanding and collaboration, we can use AI for the best of, for improving our education.
Our role as teachers, we're gonna be more or less second parents in about 10 or 15 or 20 years, rather than this, you know, great spewer of knowledge. I just had a conversation the other day with a foreign language teacher. How she was saying, am I going to be out of a job in 20 years with the pace of translation software? Will kids even need to learn Spanish if they can just get it in their AirPods? You know, and I say, maybe, but then you can start teaching about linguistics or, you know, the higher level understanding of language and so forth. So there's going to be a lot of change coming down the road, and it's going to be painful for some. It's going to be, and it definitely has massive rewards for students and massive rewards for teachers, for those who are willing to take that plunge.
Basically, my big takeaway from this is COVID has taught us that we can do far more than we ever imagined was possible in our classrooms. And I think it accelerated AI significantly and our willingness to accept it. And I think this is the time to really push this to greater heights. And it's gonna take us as teachers, us as educators, really weighing in and being willing to do the drudge work as well. Being willing to interact with the people who are creating the AI applications and giving them authentic feedback and really helping them hone in and make this a great application, because we always know policies and guidelines and codes come so far behind. Mm-hmm. by the time it takes our governments and everything else to implement guidelines, good and bad are going to already be out there. So yeah, it takes us jumping on the good platforms, the good companies, and really honing them as good as we can, and really making them beneficial and not just something else we use in the classroom.
AI allow us to make our process more transparent, definitely, more evidence-based because of the collecting data. Thank you to Javier again for this topic and for this issue. And it also allow us to make our educational process more personal, because we can construct individual educational paths, and we can adapt the process to the background, interest, and current level of expertise of each and every one of our students.
It's the computers previously weren't able to understand language, and now they can. And computers weren't able to understand images, and weren't able to see, and now they can see. And if what you have to do as a teacher, as a policymaker, as whatever role you have as a company owner, is you have to think that those new capabilities of computers, and think where the application you're and what the expectation is going to be from the applications that are going to come, because they're in the next 10, 20 years, there's gonna be a lot of applications coming.
Let's leave it there. I really appreciate everyone's time. I really learned a lot, and I look forward to staying in touch with you guys as AI moves further into the classroom. So thanks very much, and we'll be in touch over the next few years, I hope.
Okay, thank you, everybody. It was such a pleasure meeting you.
I'd like to thank everyone and Chloe for this opportunity.
Thank you all, guys, for meeting around this virtual
team. I'd like to say thank you to Craig. I appreciate you moderating this.
Thank you so much. It was amazing to realize that education is alive still throughout the world.
I'd like to say thank you for everybody here, including the moderator, Craig, and also Chloe and the Riiid team.
So that's it for this session.